Okay, Assalamualaikum. So now we are going to talk about, I'm going to talk about the last corrosion protection method, which is corrosion inhibitors, by using corrosion inhibitors. Okay, corrosion of metallic surfaces can be reduced or controlled by the addition of small quantity of chemical compound to the corrosive element. Okay, just add only a small amount of chemical. If there is a metal in this solution, you just add a small amount of chemical compound into this solution. So that chemical compound is called inhibitors. It will inhibit the process of either anodic process or cathodic process, okay, or both reaction. For example, the anodic process is metal dissolution, for example ferrum to ferrum 2 plus. The cathodic process is the hydrogen evolution, okay, this in acidic solution. So it will inhibit either this process, will stop this process, the anodic process, or the cathodic process, or both processes, okay, both reaction will be stopped, will be inhibited by the addition of small quantity of chemical compound into the corrosive environment. So the inhibitors, the corrosion inhibitors, can be classified according to this this group or this class: precipitating inhibitors, organic inhibitors, precipitation inhibitors, scavengers inhibitors, hydrogen evolution poisoning inhibitors, and volatile corrosion inhibitors. Okay, so there are many applications, especially in oil and gas industry. Okay, so look at the first class, which is the precipitating inhibitors. Okay, it can cause a large anodic shift of the corrosion potential. This is ECO. Okay, will be shifted to more positive, which it will forcing the metallic surface into the passivation range or region. Okay, so as you can, you have seen earlier, okay, in the anodic protection or protective coating, the active passive metal. Okay, so by adding the chemical, okay, into the solution, for example, chemical here, this corrosive environment. Okay, so you just add a small quantity of inhibitor into this solution. So it will make the metal, this is the metal, to be protected. Okay, this is a lab scale experiment. So the addition of these passivating inhibitors will form a passive film on top of this metal. So originally or initially, the reaction is here at the anodic or the active region. So this is the before adding the ICO. After the addition of passivating inhibitor, it moves to higher ECO. This is initial ECO. This is after adding the inhibitor, it will move to more positive. So this reaction is the inhibitor is called precipitating inhibitor, because it will cause a large anodic shift. It shift to more positive, the ECO, okay, the corrosion potential. It will force the metallic surface into passivation region or passive region. Okay, it force from active to this point, this region, passive region. So there are two types of precipitating inhibitors. One is oxidizing anion. You can use oxidizing anion such as chromate, CrO7-4-, or nitrate, NO3-, or nitrate. Okay. Okay, so it can passivate the steel in the absence of oxygen. If the solution there is no oxygen, you can use this. A good passivating inhibitor is the oxidizing anion. If in the solution contain oxygen, okay, so you can use non-oxidizing ion, okay, to passivate the steel, such as phosphate, tungstate, and molybdate. All these two types of passivating inhibitors. Okay, so what the inhibitors can do, it will passivate the metal, okay, to force the ichor from the active region to the passive region. The second class of these inhibitors is the organic inhibitors. Okay, the addition of organic inhibitors will affect the entire surface of the corroding metal when present in enough amount, okay, or concentration. This type of class of inhibitors, usually designated as film forming, protect the metal by forming protective adsorb layer. Okay, what will happen when you add organic inhibitor into the corrosive environment? So the organic inhibitor will adsorb, okay, will adsorb and form the protective layer. Okay, so organic inhibitors are adsorbed onto the metal surface either by physical adsorption or chemisorption or chemical adsorption. Physical adsorption is through electrostatic attraction. Okay, so when the metal is negative charge, so the chemical, the inhibitor, organic inhibitor is positive charge. So there is electrostatic interaction between the, this is called adsorbent, and the inhibitor is called adsorbate. Okay, when the adsorbate is positive and adsorbent is negative, there is the an interaction will occur. There is electrostatic interaction, which is very weak in the form of van der Waals attraction. But for chemisorption, that is physical adsorption, but for chemisorption involve electron transfer or the sharing of electron between the corrosion inhibitor molecule charge to the metal surface to form covalent bonding. Right? So it involves a chemical reaction between the surface of the metal and the adsorbate, the inhibitor. So a new chemical bond is generated. Okay, the adsorbent at the adsorbent surface, at the metal surface. This is adsorbent. So the new the inhibitor attached or adsorbed is called adsorbate. There is new chemical bonding form between the metal and the inhibitor. That is under this class, organic inhibitor. Next class is precipitation inhibitors. Precipitation inhibitors are compound that cause the formation of precipitate on the surface of the metal. Will provide a protective film. So this is the precipitate, okay, formed on the metal surface. Okay, this metal surface. So by adding this type of inhibitors, such as salt, divalent salt, such as zinc phosphate, zinc chromate, zinc sulfate, zinc phosphate, or chromate, added into the solution, it will react with the surface of the metal, then form the precipitate. So for example, hot water is a type of water that contains high amount of calcium ion as well as magnesium ion, divalent ion. It's less corrosive than soft water. Soft water without this divalent ion. So because of the tendency of the salt in hot water to precipitate. Okay, so these two very common divalent ion will form a precipitate. For example, calcium 2+ will react with an ion sulfate in the hot water, will form calcium sulfate precipitate. As well as magnesium will react with sulfate, will form magnesium sulfate and will deposit or precipitate on the metallic surface. Then when the metal surface coated with this precipitate, so the resistance is high. The resistance for electron transfer is high. So the metal will not dissolve, will not release the electron. So the addition of sodium pyrophosphate will cause a precipitate of calcium or magnesium orthophosphate on the metal surface. This is another example of precipitation inhibitor. It will form protective film. Next scavenger inhibitors. This another class of inhibitors. These inhibitors will act by removing corrosive reagents such as dissolved oxygen. If there is dissolved oxygen present in the solution, okay, this type of inhibitor will scavenge or remove the oxygen, dissolved oxygen from the solution. So one of the culprit or the substance that can lead to corrosion of metal is dissolved oxygen. So if you remove this oxygen, so the solution become deaerated or deoxygenated. So when the water is become deoxygenated or deaerated or without dissolved oxygen, so the metal will survive. So because there is no cathodic reaction as with the presence of oxygen. For example, this half cell reaction for cathodic. This is in acidic. If there is alkaline, so dissolved oxygen in water, okay, will accept 4 electrons to form hydroxide ion. So if there is no dissolved oxygen, by removing it using scavenger inhibitors, so the metal will survive, will not corrode, because there is no dissolved oxygen in that solution. So example of this type of inhibitors is sodium sulfide, okay, or hydrazine. So by adding sulfide, right, so when it will react with dissolved oxygen and form sulfate, okay, so it will form sulfate, then probably it will remove this dissolved oxygen, as well as hydrazine. Hydrazine is the reducing agent. It will reduce, will react with dissolved oxygen, and oxygen will reduce to form water or hydroxide. So it will scavenge the dissolved oxygen from the solution. So it is apparent that this is example. For example, without inhibitor, it probably contain dissolved oxygen. There is no, and you remove the dissolved oxygen, so you can see the nail or the metal specimen is okay. It does not corrode. So this is very the corroded specimen. Okay, this is with inhibitor. Okay, oxygen has been removed. It is apparent that such inhibitors will work very effectively in solution where oxygen reaction is the controlling corrosion cathodic reaction. So in this case, okay, this is the oxygen controlling factor for cathodic reaction. But however, it will not be effective in strong acid solution, this reaction. Okay, in strong acid, this half cell will be dominant, right? So oxygen scavengers will help to inhibit corrosion by preventing the cathodic depolarization caused by the oxygen. Next, hydrogen evolution poison inhibitors. This is another class of the inhibitors, corrosion inhibitors. So these inhibitors will retard the hydrogen evolution reaction. So this process is the hydrogen evolution reaction. Okay, another process in alkaline, so the hydrogen evolution reaction. Okay, these two. So by adding the hydrogen evolution poison inhibitors, so similar to oxygen scavengers, it will remove this, the process. For example, in this page, strong acid, okay, it will remove hydrogen plus by, for example, by adding arsenic or antimony. So arsenic will react with H plus to form arsenic hydride. Arsenic hydride. So these inhibitors are very effective in acid solution, but are not active in environment where other reduction process such as dissolved oxygen are the controlling cathodic reaction. So in this environment, it's very effective if you add arsenic or antimony. So these two element or metal will react with the hydrogen ion. will remove this H plus. So there is no hydrogen evolution reaction. It will stop the cathodic reaction. The slow cathodic reaction, compounds such as arsenic, antimony, will work by making recombination with hydrogen ion, for example, to form arsenic hydride, and discharge of hydrogen molecule become more difficult. So is the hydrogen will hardly to be evolved, hydrogen gas. Okay, we'll stop this. This is called hydrogen evolution poison. It will poison this process, hydrogen evolution process. Next, another class, the last class of these inhibitors is volatile corrosion inhibitors. Volatile corrosion inhibitors, also known as vapor phase inhibitors, compound transported in a closed environment. This is actually used in a closed system, such as piping or pipeline, okay, oil pipeline or in water pipeline, okay, in order to minimize the corrosion by volatilization from a source. For example, morpholine, hydrazine, salt of dicycloxylamine, cycloxylamine, and hexamethylamine. All these are the organic compounds that can be used because they all are volatile. Volatile, so it can add into a piping closed system. Okay, so it will volatile and absorb on the surface of the internal of the pipe. Okay, when you add in this pipeline, so it will absorb at the surface, the internal surface of the pipeline. Okay, so it is called volatile corrosion inhibitors. Okay, effect of inhibitors on corrosion process. Corrosion inhibitors in acidic solution may retard the rate of anodic process, cathodic process, or both. Okay, to identify which electrode reaction is being retarded, measuring the change in corrosion potential on addition of the inhibitors is often a useful technique. Okay, so if the inhibition is anodic type, okay, so you should recognize or see the E-core will increase more than positive 85 millivolt, more positive, okay, that, and make sure the I-core is decreased to lower than before adding the inhibitor. So actually the corrosion inhibitor affect the anodic reaction only, so it change the beta A. Okay, by adding the anodic inhibition type, okay, it will stop. For example, this process will be inhibited, will be stopped. Okay, so you stop the anodic process. Okay, in order to identify whether it's anodic, so the shift of E-core from the original E-core is more than positive 85 millivolt. But for cathodic inhibition time, okay, this is opposite. Okay, the E-core will decrease more than negative 85 millivolt. For example, this reaction will be stopped, will be inhibited. The cathodic reaction will be inhibited. So in order to check whether only this reaction is inhibited, so check the E-core movement, okay, the original to the new E-core. If it moves more negative, more than negative 85 millivolt, okay, it means that the inhibition is cathodic type, and make sure I-core also decrease. Okay, so the corrosion inhibitor affect only the cathodic reaction, only the cathodic reaction. So beta C is changed. But for mixed inhibition type, right, to identify this is the type, so both beta A and beta C are affected by the addition of this type of inhibition. So to check whether it's mixed or not, mixed type or not, so check the shift of E-core. It will shift not more than positive or negative 85 millivolt. It's very close to the original E-core. Okay, so make sure I-core will decrease. So this example, okay, see the first type, which is anodic inhibitor. So what actually occur, it stop the anodic reaction. From this line, it inhibit to this line. Okay, beta A has been affected by the addition of anodic inhibitor. ECO, this is ECO, the original ECO move to more positive, more than 85 millivolt. So this is considered as anodic inhibitor. If you plot the Teufel plot, so this is before and this after. So ECO move to more positive potential. This is E, this is I. So this is ICO before is greater than after you added the ICO. This is new ICO. ICO must decrease. ECO will move upward, more positive. So this is Teufel. Experimentally, you will get this plot. But theoretically, this even diagram. What have been changed is the beta A. If beta A, it means that it stop inhibit the anodic reaction. Only anodic reaction has been inhibited. Okay. But for cathodic inhibitor, what have been changed is the cathodic reaction from here to here. Okay. But the anodic is still the same. There is no change. For beta A, only beta C is affected. Beta C. Okay, so this is new beta C. So the ECO, this is original before here, and then after. Okay, if you plot Teufel plot, before and this one after. So this is ECO before adding. This is after adding. So it moved downward more than negative 85 millivolt. And make sure ICO after adding is less. ICO after is less than before. Okay, that is called inhibitor. So it stopped cathodic reaction. It just affect the beta C. But for mixed inhibitor, so before here and after here, it's very close. ECO just move to more positive or more negative. But ICO still decrease or reduce to lower value. So this is called mixed type. It affects both beta C and beta A. Both slope have been affected. So this is example. The addition of eugenol, this is inhibitor, in a pH2 solution. So ECO has been shifted from negative 1. You also can plot this way, E here and I here. You will get V shape, right? V shape. So the ECO have been shifted to from negative 1.1 here, negative 1.1 to negative 0.98. okay, it's about 100 positive, 120 more positive. Okay, so more than positive 85 millivolt. Okay, and ICO, this is before ICO and this is after. Okay, reduce to lower value. So eugenol has increased the corrosion protection efficiency of the metal. So the shift is more than 85 positive 85 millivolt. This is anodic type inhibitor. Okay, this is some example of inhibitors commercially available to protect the metallic surface or application of inhibitors. Okay, for water environment and acid pickling in oil and gas industry. Alright. So next, corrosion protection efficiency measurement. Okay, a high current equivalent to low resistance. Okay, so high current is mean high correction rate, and low correction rate means low current, high resistance. Okay, so this another one more formula in order to calculate I core. This is RP, resistance, polarization resistance. This is RP of material, is defined as the slope of the potential, okay, versus current density at free corrosion potential. Leading polarization resistance RP that can be rated for reaction under activation control. So this is Teufel's plot. Okay, so there are four method can be used to measure the corrosion potential efficiency. One is weight loss, okay, by immerse the metal into the corrosive environment and weight before and after the process. Two is the Teufel polarization curve or Teufel plot. Okay, this curve V shape. Third is the linear polarization resistance. Fourth is using electrochemical impedance spectroscopy, EIS. You can measure the resistance. So this is formula, polarization resistance. This is beta, the slope of anodic, slope of cathodic. Okay, this is I core. So for this formula, beta C, you don't have to put negative sign. Okay, please omit this, or this is negligible. Okay, remove negative, you will use when using this formula. So for Teufel, you will get these two line or at high over potential. Okay, then you get this value. It's very important. This is I core. Okay, to put into this formula or the corrosion rate formula. But for linear polarization resistance, they will measure this very close to the E core or OCP, open circuit potential here. Okay, it's about plus minus 10 millivolt, very close to OCP, from the OCP. This is about more than 50 millivolt, plus minus. Okay, the linear here for Teufel. But for LPR, very close to OCP. This is OCP, open circuit potential, or E core, corrosion potential. Okay, so this linear, then it will plot this. This is the zero, is the OCP. OCP. So we'll take linear 10 millivolt plus and minus, then we'll get a slope. This slope is polarization resistant and will be included into this formula. You can find the I core if you know beta A, beta C from the graph, beta A and beta C. Alright, so this is called linear polarization resistance. It's about plus minus 10 millivolt from OCP. This OCP is about 10 millivolt from this. This is minus 10 millivolt. This is plus 10 millivolt from OCP. So you will get straight line, so you can find the resistance. This is delta E. This is delta I. Delta E was, over delta I, you will get RP, polarization resistance. Then you must, you can use this equation. Okay, in order to find the corrosion protection efficiency of an inhibitor or other methods, you can use this formula. So this is the corrosion protection efficiency in percentage. Okay, this is RP. If you use RP, so this is the protected or inhibited, minus RP for blank, and then over the RP of the protected or inhibited times 100. If you also can use these two other formulas, okay, so this is your corrosion rate, the opposite of this one. RP is proportional to I and R. Okay, you can use R. Instead of RP, you can use R, but this is blank. The greater number than the inhibitor. Okay, this is I, inhibitor. This is blank. It's opposite. This is inhibitor, this is blank. This is inhibitor. But for conversion rate and I core, because they are opposite to RP, so you must use the value of blank first, then minus the inhibitor divided with the blank times 100. These two are similar, but this is different because they are opposite. Okay, so that's all. Thank you.